My name is Dean Claypatch. I have some announcements for you today. They are in your bulletin if I miss any of them. I was just thinking about the weather, you know, how unseasonably warm it's been this month. We had, was it 50? Did we have 60 degrees or 58, 59? And I went out this morning and there was frost on my windshield and I go, whoa, when, that's kind of weird. But I realized it still isn't even mid-February yet, so we've had a nice warm spell here. A few announcements for you today. We do have a women's Bible study happening after the service. There is an announcement about the next study coming up on February 18th. The women will gather today for a short prayer meeting. So today they will meet, you know, I believe it's in the first Sunday school room in the fellowship, past the fellowship hall on the right. So it'll be a little shorter today, just a prayer time for the next study. So if you can gather for that, that'll be great. Today we have two breaking of bread groups who meet and remember the Lord's Supper together and share a meal together. The Greg's group, which is meeting at Paula's house today, meeting at 1 o'clock, and I believe it's soup, right? Soup day, a variety of different, so it sounded pretty good from what I heard. I may be switching groups just for today, because I'm a fan of split pea soup, and I want to test it, just to see if it's good. Our group usually meets at 6 p.m., and you may have heard there is a certain sporting event that's happening today. So our group, to hit full participation, is meeting a different week. When is that, Mike? Is it next week? A week from today. So we've postponed ours. So if you want to get meals at both groups, you can hopscotch between both of them. But it is one of the things that we're talking with our leader earlier, we are commanded to do, is to remember the Lord coming for us. And so it is a good time there. So for more information, you can talk to me or Mike about next week or Greg about this week. That is it for our announcements today. A reminder, we don't, if you want to make an offering, there's a box in front of, you can place it in by the stained glass window. Ever since COVID, we no longer pass a plate anymore. Thank you for being here today. And I believe Chris will come up and pray. We will pray in our service together and have a chance to worship after that.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to be with you all, ready to worship the Lord together as brothers and sisters. We're continuing our conversations about those who have come before us in the faith today and looking at the character of Mary. Why don't you join me in prayer as we get ready to worship the Lord together and joining that conversation. Lord, thank you so much that we have the opportunity as brothers and sisters, as the body of Christ, to gather to worship you and be edified by what you have done. Help us to steady our hearts and our minds as we bring them into one place to worship the Lord our God and what you have done, and to reflect today on how we can draw closer to you. In your son's name we pray, amen.
Thanks, Chris. How about if everybody stands up and we'll join in worshiping the Lord in song this morning.
Before me, the world behind, no turning back. Raise the banner high, it's now for us, it's all for you. Let the heavens shake, it's with the sky. Let the people clap their hands and cry, it's time for us, it's all for you. Now to us. For the world to see, it's not for us, it's all for you.
teaching this morning is about humility, and the Lord actually spoke to me yesterday as I was kind of getting ready for today about how pride tells us that there are things that we need to hold on to. But it's only when we're humble and we open our hands to the Lord that He can fill them with the good things that He has for us. I was praying about some anxiety that I'd had through the week about a work issue, and the Lord showed me pretty clearly two things that I was hanging on to. One was being able to figure out what to do, and the other was being able to avoid damaging criticism. And it was because I was holding on to those things that I was anxious. That's what was making me anxious. And I was holding on to those really tightly, like my life depended on hanging on to these two things. And the Lord just showed me that, A, there are some things that only He knows what to do and when to do it. And B, that I don't have to be smarter or better or more clever in order for Him to want to be with me. And then He led me to read Psalm 27, where David's in the midst of this chaos, and he says, one thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. And then he concludes with, I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart, and wait for the Lord. And David was able to focus instead of hanging on to his position as king or his safety and security. He was open-handed to the Lord to receive His strength and His courage to go on. So as we sing these next two songs, I just encourage you to take that opportunity to open your hands to the Lord and to see what good things He has for you. These songs I pulled out of the mothballs. But they fit so well, I just couldn't resist. So if you're not familiar with them, they're fairly simple to catch on to. You can join us when you feel comfortable.
I am weak,
depths of my soul, Lord, I want you to know that this life that I live is for you. Every breath, Lord, all that I am, I want my life to bring you glory. Every
you.
Continue with our service. Let's take a few minutes to greet each other in the Lord.
All right, everybody, please find your seats. Today marks the kickoff of, we're splitting our Sunday school class in two starting today. So praise the Lord for that. We're going to have the middle schoolers separate from the elementary age. So we thank the Lord for that. This week marks the beginning of what the traditional church calls a season of Lent. And some denominations have specific traditions associated with this part of the church calendar, but the overarching spirit of the Lenten season is a challenge for each believer to have a time of personal assessment of their walk with Christ. So there's 40 days between this Wednesday, which the traditional church calls Ash Wednesday, and Easter, and it gives us a time to step back from our day-to-day busyness and give some extra attention and focus spiritual health. So as the church worldwide enters the season this week, let us pray together that for this time for ourselves as well. Please bow with me. Lord God, Holy One, we confess our sins and that we have fallen short of your glory. Without your mercy, without your grace as demonstrated on the cross, we would be lost. We would be dust, Lord. We would be doomed. But thank you for rescuing us. We repent now, Lord, as we enter this Lenten season. Let us, Lord, to evaluate our walk with you over these next 40 days. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would guide us in changes that we need to make, bad habits we need to drop, things that we're negligent of, Lord, people whom we need to seek restoration, spiritual habits that we need to form, steps of faith that you want us to make that we've held back out of fear or apathy. Lord, help us to take those steps. Thank you, Jesus, that Easter is coming, where we're reminded that death has no sting and no victory because of your great sacrifice for us, Jesus. Thank you that through your resurrection, our resurrection is secured in you, Jesus. Help us keep both the weight and the joy of this next season in our hearts as we move through the next several weeks, and help us bear good fruit of your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. The reading from today is a selection from Songs of the Nativity, which is a collection of John Calvin's Christmas sermons. And Elizabeth, was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed, "Blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior." Here, Elizabeth indicates the real reason why Mary is to be praised. It is because she was obedient to the word which the angel brought her. That, then, is the essential quality we ought to note about Mary. We should not judge according to our own estimate or understanding, but according to the truth which Elizabeth utters in the power of the Holy Spirit. Although this passage is about the Virgin Mary, it is relevant to each and every one of us. Here we have God declaring through Elizabeth that Mary is blessed because she believes. By that, he means that if we trust in his promises and firmly cling to them, if we make them the ground of our salvation, our happiness is complete. How is it possible for us to rejoice in God? The Virgin Mary supplies us with the answer when she says, "In God my Savior." That is where our joy begins, with the assurance that God is for us, a Savior. To rejoice in God is impossible until we experience the love he has for us and until we know that he will not desert us but will lead us on to the end. To sum up, from Mary we learn that to praise God we first need faith and that we are moved to praise by the assurance of his goodwill toward us.
All right. Well, good morning again, everyone. If you have a Bible this morning, go ahead and turn to Luke 1. This is where we'll be parked for most of the morning. The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. As we talked about at the beginning of the service today, we are continuing to look at the lives of those who have come before us, the heroes of our faith, trying to see what can we take away from their lives and their obedience to God. What can we learn from them and practice and rejoice in our own lives? And in the entirety of Christendom, there are very few people as revered as the Virgin Mary. These first couple verses here in Luke 1 set up the setting and the characters for our story this morning. It's taking place, as most of the stories do in the New Testament, in the backwaters of the Roman Empire, in the region of Judea, in a very small rural town named Nazareth, which it's pretty tiny. It probably doesn't have more than a few hundred people living in it. So it's definitely one of those places where everybody knows everybody. And Mary is this virgin who is betrothed or engaged to a man, a carpenter named Joseph. And she's just a young teenage girl, probably between the ages of 13 and 16. So she's just bopping around doing teenage girl stuff. If you are a parent of a teenage girl, you have an idea of what she's just probably interested in, what she's going through at this time in her life. And she's engaged again, which is very normal at this time in Jewish culture for a girl of that age, until her life is disrupted by this divine messenger, Gabriel, who shows up in her house one day while she's just doing teenage girl stuff. And he says, starting in verse 28, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled by the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive." Oh, that's later though. So she hears this greeting from Gabriel, and she's greatly troubled by it, even though it sounds favorable. Like, why would you be troubled by this, Mary, that, you know, you found favor with God? Isn't that a good thing? Well, it'd be a little bit like this. It'd be like if you left church this morning and you're walking out the doors and then you hear someone call your name out. You turn and all of a sudden there is the King of England and his entourage, and he's heading right for you, and he comes up to you and he grabs your hand and he's like, "Oh, I am so glad to meet you. I have heard so many good things. you would be a little troubled and take it aback. Like, this is one of the most prominent monarchs on the planet, and he knows who I am, and he's heard things about me, and he's happy to meet me. What is about to happen? So if you take yourself now and put yourself in the shoes of a young teenage girl, and you scale up the king to, I don't know, the god of your entire people, and say, hey, God thinks you're favorable. You might be taken a little bit aback by that, and Mary certainly is, because she doesn't know what's about to happen next. But Gabriel calms her and says, don't be afraid. I'm going to tell you what the Lord is about to do. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom, there will be no end. Your son, you're going to have a son. He's going to be great. He's going to sit on the throne of the most famous monarch in your people's history. And he's going to reign over the house of Israel. And there will be no limit to what he will do and the reach and extent of his rule and reign. And you will be his mother. It's astounding. It's extraordinary what is about to happen. But there's a phrase here that makes Mary furrow her brow, and it's this one at the very beginning. She doesn't really talk about the rest of the stuff, but she thinks about this first phrase, and about it, she has just one question. What? This is maybe a little too far in terms of like how she would have reacted in extreme, but she does wonder, like, wait a minute, like, the math's not adding up here. Like, I am not in the position where that is possible. Like, I know how this works. It's not, I don't understand. And she asks this, how will this be since I'm a virgin? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. God is going to do something that has never been done before. And to let you know that it is possible, behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. So if you remember the Christmas story in previous verses in chapter 1, Elizabeth had already received kind of the same message from Gabriel, that she would conceive a son. And she is well beyond childbearing years. There's no reason why she should be able to have a son, kind of like Abraham and Sarah back in the Old Testament. And Gabriel lets her know, like, something unprecedented is going to happen with you, Mary, and something similar has already happened to Elizabeth. God will do the things that we know are impossible. And Mary just says, okay. She doesn't try to back out of it. She doesn't make excuses. She doesn't complain or make, like, I don't know if this is for me. I'm peace out. She says, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And then the angel departed. And this is such an admirable response. Imagine if you're a young teenager and everything is going according to plan, and then a divine messenger comes and he disrupts your entire life with this message. What would you do? What would you think? And Mary's heart posture is one that is admirable. In her humility, she responds very well. But there's still a little bit of trouble. It's a lot to process. There's a lot of things going through her head. Who can I talk to about this? I can't really talk to my friends right about this right now. I don't know what Joseph's going to think quite yet. I definitely can't tell my parents at the moment. Like, no one is in my small town is going to understand this. I'm going to go see Elizabeth. Because if what Gabriel said is true, she is the only person on the planet right now who understands what's happening to me. So she packs her bags and leaves and goes to see Elizabeth. And for some reason, when I read the Christmas story, I always imagine that, like, hey, they had like a scheduled date already in mind and they were going to meet anyway. Or she just kind of moseys on over there to be like, hey, Elizabeth, guess what? And she tells her what's happening. But I'd always miss these words, with haste. She just immediately packs her bags and zips off. So she's like, I got to go see Elizabeth. I have to talk to someone and be with someone who can help me process what has just been told to me. And she meets Elizabeth. She comes into her house, and as soon as she does, we know the story, Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit and feels her baby, John, leap up in her womb for joy as soon as she hears Mary's voice. It's a very divine meeting. And Elizabeth has some things to say to Mary as soon as she comes through the door. And picking up in verse 41. When Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is it granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." This is exactly what Mary needs to hear in this moment, because Elizabeth has no idea. Like, Mary left with haste. She's not showing. She hasn't had a chance to, like, write Elizabeth beforehand. She just zips off, and as soon as she walks in the door, Elizabeth tells her everything that she's been thinking and blesses her through the Holy Spirit. God knows, and God sees, and says, "Mary, I see you, and I know what you're thinking and what you're feeling. Here is what you need to hear." And that is a huge relief to Mary. It causes her to rejoice and sing a song, something we typically call the Magnificent. There they are greeting one another with joy. And we won't read the entire song, but she says, this is what I needed to hear. "Praise the Lord. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name." And what's interesting is most of Mary's story in terms of what is going to happen hasn't happened yet externally to us, but internally she's had a lot that's happened to her. And she says, "The Lord has done great things for me." She's experienced that and felt that. And she says a phrase that's very interesting here that we always tend to highlight. "From now on, all generations will call me blessed." Why? Well, mainly, of course, because she is the son or the mother of the Son of God. But there's also some character traits that make her favorable for that make Mary, Mary. And since I'm going to guess most of us are not getting ready to bear or conceive a divine being, we have to look at those character traits that make Mary, Mary, and see what can we learn from her. If she is so blessed and revered, how can we pull character traits from her person and try to emulate them and imitate them in our walk with Christ? And even in just this short spit of a story in Mary's life, there's several things that she does and responds to correctly that we can imitate too. The first thing that I see Mary do in this story is submit in humility to God, even when she is overwhelmed by his message. It's a pretty big thing that the Lord is saying is going to happen. And culturally, at that time, if you were found to be with child and you weren't married, and especially if you were engaged to someone who's married, and they're under the right circumstances, or perhaps the wrong circumstances, that was something that you could get killed for. You could be stoned for. And Mary is probably very acutely aware of that. And she doesn't know how that's going to work. She doesn't know, like, what does it mean that you're, like, I'm going to just have a kid all of a sudden? Like, even if when Gabriel explains it, there's probably a lot of details that are missing in her mind. She's like, I don't understand how that works. But in the moment, she submits in her humility. She follows the Lord's word, even though she does not understand what is happening to her or how it's all going to play out. And that is a heart trait that God is constantly trying to temper in us, to be humble before him, to put ourselves in a position where we are seeing ourselves in right relation to God. We're here, you're God, I'm going to obey and follow you because you are the Lord. There's several times that this phrase shows up in Scripture. Peter references it. God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And Mary is a woman who is full of grace and full of humility. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. And that's kind of the crux of Mary's song. I am in a humble estate, and the Lord has lifted me up because she obeyed, because she submitted to God's will fully. And that's a decision we have to make. When we get out of bed every day and our feet hit the floor, are we ready to submit to God's will today toward whatever end? What does God want to do? the things that he desires and that he is playing at and that he is pushing forward in my life are so much more than I could ever imagine or even like contemplate and plan for. Am I willing to just submit to God today and do what he wants me to do in humility? The second thing that I see Mary do is that she seeks fellowship. As soon as she has heard this thing that God wants her to do, she seeks out Elizabeth with haste. She goes and she doesn't try and make herself stay alone or try and isolate herself. Like, I got to figure this out. I got to take care of this. I have to, as Robin was talking about this morning, hold on. I have to avoid the bad consequences. I have to get the results. I have to do this. I will take care of this. She doesn't. She says, no, there's a lot happening here. I need to join in fellowship with someone who will understand this. And that is part of our life as well as Christians. We don't do this alone. We're not little islands trying to follow Christ. We're together, brothers and sisters, the body of Christ, dwelling and enriching each other until we mature into Christ, the head of the body. That's what Paul exhorts us to do. And he exhorts us here in Galatians, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. This theme shows up throughout most of the writings in the New Testament, that most of the of what God wants us to do, what Christ has commanded us to do, is fulfilled when we come alongside each other and help each other in our own journeys. Do I see that you're burdened? Can I help carry your burden? Do I let others shoulder my burden? Those are questions we can be asking ourselves in our walk. Do we allow ourselves, our others, to bear our burden with us? Or do we hold on to it? Like, no, this is mine, I'll take care of this. Or do we allow ourselves to be open and vulnerable to our brothers and sisters so we can receive help and grace in time of need, comfort, build each other up? Are we willing to come alongside each other and help each other with our burdens? James says if we see a brother who's in need, like, man, things are really hard, I don't have any food, it's cold, if we go, man, be warm, be blessed, I'll be praying for you, and we just kind of walk off, that is not living out the life of Christ. If we see a burden, can we respond to a burden? Can we help each other in the way? Build each other up and encourage one another. That's exactly what Elizabeth does for Mary. Mary seeks out that fellowship. The third thing I see her do is that she believed God would follow through on the seemingly impossible. So it's one thing to say, yes, I'll submit, but you can also go, I don't know if that's going to work out, but I know it's okay for me to obey. And she does both. She humbles herself and submits, and she also believes that God will follow through on what he says, and because it, and that it's impossible, but God will do it anyway. How do we know that she believes this? Well, because Elizabeth says so. When she is speaking to Mary through the Holy Spirit, the last line there is that she says, blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. And Mary hasn't said two words to Elizabeth other than, hi. Like, that's, she comes across the threshold and greets her, and Elizabeth says, you're blessed because you believed that there'd be a fulfillment of the Lord. That's exactly what Mary was thinking. Like, I don't know, is this, I have to see, like, Elizabeth is the only one who'll know. I'm going to trust that that's happened to Elizabeth, because Elizabeth also has been hidden in her pregnancy early on in the details of the story, so not many people know she's pregnant at that time. Mary doesn't, because Gabriel has to tell her, and she trusts that God has done this and will do it in her life. And that is why, one of the reasons why she's blessed, because she believed that God would do the things that he said he was going to do. And that's kind of a necessary requirement for any deep, long-lasting, intimate relationship, is that you trust the person, that they're going to do the things they say they're going to do. And the scripture is full of promises like this one where God says, hey, you do a thing, I'll do a thing, or I'm going to do a thing, and can you walk in that thing that I've said I'm going to do? And our growth in those moments kind of rely on us trusting that God means what he says when he says certain things. Do I pray as if I believe this is true? If I abide in Jesus and his words abide in me, if I pray to him, it will be done. When I sit down and I pray, do I pray with expectation that God is going to do something, that he's hearing me, first of all, and that he cares about my prayers, and that he's going to do something with them, like this verse says? Do I trust him daily for my daily bread? Do I walk with him? Do I pray for things as if I believe this is true? Do I trust that God will follow through on what he says he is going to do? And the more of those promises that we're able to believe and trust in our walk, when we see them, the more we mature into Christ, that we've become fully dependent and reliant upon God. And that is a very good place to be. And these are things that Mary all does in a very short span of time in this story. It's this beautiful balance she strikes of being, I'm kind of nervous, I'm troubled by what's going on, but in the midst of that, I'm going to make sure I'm connecting with someone, I'm going to submit in humility to God, and I'm going to believe him. I'm going to trust, even though this is crazy, I'm going to trust him. And when we are doing these things, when these things are growing in us daily, we're becoming more and more fruitful as followers of Christ. When we are checking, am I being humble before God? Am I connecting with people, the church? Do I trust God for the things he says he is going to do? These things keep us fruitful. They make us fruitful. And in times of plenty, they prepare us for the storms that will inevitably come. They build in us and reinforce a rich character that is reliant upon the bulwark of our faith when it is battered by the storms of life, which are inevitable. And she is going to need these things through the things she is going to go through. I mean, anyone will tell you, and I know especially recently, that having a child in ideal circumstances is stressful, right? Even in today's modern day, let alone what Mary has to go through. So she has to deal with that normal stress, but also if you go back to her time, like the mortality rate for infants is pretty high, let alone the mortality rate for the mother, and that's if things are ideal and you have a midwife, which Mary has neither. In fact, she has to give birth to her baby in one of the most unsanitary places you could give birth to a baby. And then she has no really effective way to keep the baby warm, and she has to figure out, how do I feed a baby? And like the only person there to help her is Joseph, and he's probably also stressed out. And then after these shepherds come by, which is kind of weird, and they come and visit the baby, Mary thinks it's great because the text tells Mary thinks it's great. They go to sleep like, wow, that was stressful. And they have a dream. It's like, hey, hi, Gabriel here again. The ruler of your people knows that you've had a kid and he wants him dead. So you need to go. And so they do what everyone advises you not to do, and that's travel with the baby. And they just go down to Egypt to hide out for a couple years. And no one knows where they are because they're trying to hide. And that's just really stressful. And Mary needs that total trust and humility to make it through that event. We read the nativity story. I'm like, wow, isn't that beautiful? And she's like, oh my gosh. Everything's just really hard. But she stays the course. She possesses the humility and trust in God. Just say, okay. Like the impossible has already happened, so let's go to Egypt. Let's just do it. And that character that makes Mary Mary centers her in God. From the moment that she gets to hold in wonder her newborn son in her arms to the moment that they pull his lifeless body off of a cross. She has to endure a lot as a mom. But she also gets to experience a lot of joy with that. God pulls her into this amazing place where she sees what Gabriel said, the impossible happen again and again and again and again. She gets to see her son grow up and do impossible things and save the world. She gets to see that and live that, have a special connection to that, both as a mother and as a woman who had this character that was centered in God and was trusting him for the impossible. She gets to be part of this in a huge way. Maybe the biggest part was being his mom. And it's her character that allows her to stay centered in God during this incredible journey that's full of great lows and even greater highs that none of us, Mary couldn't have when she was 16, could have imagined. But her humility and her fellowship with others and her trust in her God give us, such a great example in our own walks to imitate, to meditate on. Can we do these things like Mary did these things? They are an outpouring of her character, the character of a young woman who was favored by God to be the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ. Mother and maiden was never anyone but she. Well may such a lady, God's mother, be. Why don't you join me in prayer? Lord, we thank you so much for the obedience and humility that your mother Mary showed to us. We thank you for your divine plan and that Mary got to play a role in it that was unique, and that we, as your followers, as the body of Christ, also get to play roles. Please help us to trust you fully, like Mary did, to be humble and to continually put ourselves in positions where we're connecting with the body of Christ. Help us all to grow in the unique way that we need to grow today and to trust you for our daily bread. In your Son's name we pray, amen.
Mary's humility is such a beautiful picture of the humility of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and part of the plan for him to come humble himself to death, even death on a cross for our sakes. Let's stand and close out our service with a couple of songs.
Redemption's here, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured. Sin and death. Now you're risen. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Lord, I lay me down.
cross I look, to the cross I cling. Of his suffering I do drink, of his word I do sing. Worshiping with us this morning. Go in peace and have a great week.